children, welcome back to Economics with your favorite teacher, me, Mr. Fritz. Today we're going to talk about opportunity costs and comparative advantage. All right, children, today we're going to continue talking about opportunity costs. This time we're going to use opportunity costs to set up trade between countries. Just before we get started, let's get some concepts and definitions down. We already talked about opportunity costs, but I think it's helpful to have it on this very same page. You can write it down right now. Remember, your opportunity costs is essentially when you're making a decision, an economic decision, your opportunity cost is the value of the next best thing you could have done. So over here to the side, we've got Mexico and Canada, and they're producing either cars or computers. So for Mexico, every time they make a car, their opportunity cost is whatever computer they're not making anymore. So that's just what opportunity cost is. They've made this economic decision, so their opportunity cost is the other economic decision that they're foregoing, in this case, computers. Now, when it comes to trade between nations, trade is based on one thing, comparative advantage. So first, we'll talk about absolute advantage. So we're going to talk about absolute advantage now. When we're talking about absolute advantage between two countries, we're talking about who can make more. Given the same amount of resources, who can produce more of a given product? If you look down here, we have planes and phones, and we're looking at the USA and Japan. Who can make more of planes and phones? If we look at the US, given the same amount of resources, the US could make 20 planes and Japan could make 10. That means that the US has the absolute advantage on producing airplanes. Given the same amount of resources, they can just make more straight up. For Japan, they have the absolute advantage of producing smartphones. They can make 15 smartphones in an hour or a day or whatever this is supposed to be, where US can make 5. So Japan is going to have the absolute advantage in producing smartphones. 15 is greater than 5. Let's go back up and take a look. Now, trade is not based on absolute advantage. It doesn't matter who can make more. It matters who can make it for a cheaper amount. So trade is based on comparative advantage. Comparative advantage is going to be the country that can produce an item for a lower opportunity cost. Who gives up the least amount of the other product? And that's how we figure out our trade. Trade, again, our terms of trade are going to be based on comparative advantage, which in turn is based on opportunity cost. Think about the United States and Mexico. The United States has a greater population than Mexico. We also have more factories around the country because we're a bigger country. If we wanted to, we could, if we focus solely on producing cars, we could make more cars than Mexico. However, cars are produced in Mexico and Americans buy cars from Mexico every day. And the reason for that is because Mexico has a comparative advantage in producing cars. They can make them for cheaper than we can. And so we, in turn, import them into the US, even though we have the capacity to build them ourselves. So remember, comparative advantage. Who can make it for the lower opportunity costs? And our terms of trade are going to be based on comparative advantage. Let's go down to the bottom and do an example. Right now, we have the US and Japan, and we're deciding whether we're going to produce airplanes or smartphones. Our comparative advantage, we've already figured out our absolute advantage. Now we need to figure out comparative advantage. This is an output problem. And so you need to write at the top here, output equals the other goes over. And what that means is when we're trying to figure out our opportunity cost of producing one plane in the United States, you take the other number and put it over. So 5 divided by 20. 5 divided by 20 is going to be 1/4. So when the United States produces one airplane, they're giving up 1/4 of a smartphone. When Japan produces one airplane, the other number goes over, 15 over 10. Every airplane that Japan produces, they give up 1.5 smartphones. And so what's a smaller number, 1/4 or 1.5? 1/4 smaller. So the US is going to be producing planes, and that automatically means that Japan is going to be producing smartphones. Let's take a look though and figure that out for sure. When we figure out the opportunity cost of producing one smartphone for the US, you take the other number, 20, and put it over. 20 divided by 5 is 4. For Japan, you take the other number and put it over. 10 divided by 15 is 2/3. 2/3 is less than 4. Japan is going to be producing smartphones. Now, would Japan agree to be trading 2 phones for 1 plane? Japan is going to be making the phones because they have the lower opportunity costs for producing phones, or they have the comparative advantage, we should say. Every time Japan wants to get 1 plane, they have to give up 1.5 smartphones. Are they going to be happy trading 2 smartphones for the US for 1 plane? No, that is not a good trade for the United States. A fair trade would be anything less than 1.5 smartphones for 1 plane. So they'd be happy with just 1 smartphone for plane. That would work for them. It would also work for the US because anytime they get 1 smartphone, they have to give up 4 planes. So they too would be happy to trade 1 for 1. We'll talk about more of that later, and I'll give you an example in a minute.
All right, so I just wanted to show you real quick how I actually would work this problem out, not just over the computer. So first thing I did is I put everything, for both countries, the United States and Japan, I put the goods that they were producing into a table so I could better look at what I've got going on. Remember, this is an output problem. The problem states, given the same resources, so the same labor hours, the same materials, like metal and whatever else it would take to produce phones or planes, in 1 day or 1 hour, the US can make 5 phones, Japan can make 15, the US can make 20 planes, Japan can make 10. Because this is an output problem and we're using equal resources, the other number is going to go over. So when I want to find out what the opportunity cost is of producing 1 phone in the United States, I take the planes, the other number, and put it over. So 20 divided by 4 is going to come out, 20 divided by 5 is going to come out to 4 planes. So every time the US makes 1 phone, they give up 4 planes. For Japan to find out the opportunity cost of making 1 phone, we take the planes, the other number, put it over. So instead of the other goes over, 10 over 15 comes out to 2/3 of a plane. So what we see here is that when the US makes a phone, they give up 4 planes. Japan only gives up 2/3 of a plane to make a phone. Japan has the comparative advantage in producing phones. So phones are going to be made by Japan, and that means that definitely the planes will be made by the USA. But we can do the math again. To find out opportunity cost of making 1 plane, the other goes over, 5 over 20, and that's going to equal 1/4 of a phone. 15 over 10, that's going to equal 1 1/2 phone. So that's going to equal 1.5 phones, and that means that the US gives up a smaller amount of phone to get a plane. Okay, now that we know our opportunity costs, we can set up our terms of trade. I want to find out, or we're asked to find out, would Japan be willing to trade away 2 phones for 2 planes? When I write these things out, first thing I like to do is highlight who's doing what. Japan is making phones, so I'm just going to throw that on top, Japan, and the USA is making planes. All right, would Japan be happy trading away 2 phones for 1 plane? No, they would not. When they produce planes domestically, they only have to give up 1.5 phones. So they are not going to be happy giving up 2 phones to get 2 planes. For the US, every time they make 1 phone, they have to give up 4 planes. So for the US, giving up 2 planes to get back 2 phones is going to be great for them. But it's not going to work out for Japan, and they're not going to be happy. A better deal would be 1 for 1. Both countries would be happy with a 1 for 1 trade. If Japan got back a whole plane every time they gave up 1 phone, that would be better than giving up 1.5. And for the US, they have to give up 4 planes to get 1 phone. So giving up 1 plane for 1 phone would be great for them. So a 1 for 1 deal would be a good thing for both countries. This 2 for 2 works for the US, does not work for Japan.
Let's come up to the input method now. Input method is a little bit different. With the input method, we're talking about, we're not given the same inputs. This is how long or how much resources it takes for each country to produce the same good. So if you look here, it takes Mexico 40 hours to produce one car and 20 hours to produce one computer. It takes Canada 30 hours to produce one car and 10 hours to produce one computer. So absolute advantage is a little different. It's actually the smaller number when we're talking about the input method. 30 hours to make one car is quicker than 40 hours to make one car. So Canada has the absolute advantage on producing cars. Again, Canada has the absolute advantage on producing computers too, because 10 hours to make one computer is quicker than 20 hours to make a car. Than 20 hours to make a computer. That does not mean that Canada and Mexico will not trade, because trade is based on comparative advantage, not absolute advantage. So now we got to figure out our comparative advantage.
All right, children. So now I'm going to show you an example of finding comparative advantage through opportunity cost by using the input method. Before I show you the output method, where both countries use the same exact amount of resources to get a certain amount of goods. This, however, is the input method. And it's the input method because instead of both countries using equal resources, this tells you how much input each good needs. So this one says hours of labor per car. So we're looking at Mexico taking 40 hours to produce a car, whereas Canada takes 30 hours. And then Mexico needing 20 hours of labor to produce a computer, whereas Canada needs 10 hours of labor to produce a computer. Now, in order to find the opportunity cost, so that we can figure out who has the comparative advantage and what good, we're going to need to instead take the other number and put it under. So because this is an input problem, it's other goes under. So in order to figure out the opportunity cost of one car, we take the other good that we could have made, our computers, and put it under. So 40 divided by 2 is going to come out to 2 computers. Every time Mexico makes one car, they could have made 2 computers. For Canada, again, we take the other number, the computers, and put it under 30 divided by 10. Every time that Canada makes one car, they give up the production of 3 computers. So, who has the lower opportunity cost? Mexico gives up fewer computers in order to produce one car. 2 is smaller than 3. So Mexico will be producing cars, and that means that Canada must be producing computers. But let's do the math real quick. For computers for Mexico, other goes under, 20 over 40. That's going to equal 1/2 of a car. Every time Mexico makes one computer, they give up 1/2 a car. And then again, other goes under, 10 over 30 comes out to 1/3. 1/3 car. So Mexico has a comparative advantage in producing cars, whereas Canada has the comparative advantage in producing computers. Now, let's look at our terms of trade. All right, so we're supposed to be figuring out if 2.5 computers for one car, if that's a fair trade for both of these countries. First, I like to write it out like this, and then remind myself which good each country is producing. So the cars are going to be made by Mexico, so I'm just going to write that above Mexico so I can remember that that's who's making the car. And then the computers are obviously then going to be made by Canada. Okay, for Mexico, domestically, when they give up the production of one car, they get back 2 computers. So Mexico is going to be happy with this trade, because if they're giving up one car for 2.5 computers, that's better than they could do it on their own. For Canada, every time they want one car, they have to give up 3 computers. 2.5 computers is less than 3, so they're going to be happy too. Remember, to figure out these trade deals, so obviously first, this is a good trade deal. Everybody's going to be happy with that. To figure out what a good trade deal is, you just have to find something between the opportunity costs. So one car, anything between 2 and 3 computers was going to be good for both countries. You could go all the way from 2.1 computers and Mexico would be happy, as long as it didn't get down to 2, because then they could just do it on their own, or all the way up to 2.9 computers, because anything less than 3 would keep Canada happy. All right, hopefully that helped out. We'll keep talking about this stuff, and soon we'll be moving on to supply and demand. Goodbye, children.